The St. Regis Parish family gathers for the second Sunday of Easter. Please stand.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
My brothers and sisters, as we gather together today to celebrate these sacred mysteries, we gather on this eighth day of Easter, which completes the Easter octave, remembering that at the moment of our baptism, we became Christ for others. We renew our baptism into His death and resurrection. And let us praise God for the gift of life-giving water. The water that we use was blessed at the Easter Vigil. We'll be using throughout the Easter season for sprinkling to remind us of our baptism. And so we have no need to bless the water. It's already blessed. So we offer God our thanksgiving. And our response to each of these invocations is, "Blessed be God." Father, God of mercy, through the waters of baptism, you have filled us with new life as your very own children. From all who are baptized in water and the Holy Spirit, you have formed one people united in your Son, Jesus Christ. You have set us free and filled our hearts with the Spirit of your love, that we may live in your peace. You call those who have been baptized to announce the good news of Jesus Christ to people everywhere. And may Almighty God cleanse us of our sins, and through the celebration of this Eucharist, make us worthy to share at the table of His kingdom. Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of God.
Let us pray. God of everlasting mercy, who in the very recurrence of the Paschal feast kindled the faith of the people you have made your own, increase the grace you have bestowed, that all may grasp and rightly understand in what font we have been washed, by whose spirit we have been reborn, by whose blood we have been redeemed. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. The community of believers was of one heart and mind, and no one claimed that any of his possessions was his own, but they had everything in common. With great power, the apostles bore witness to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great favor was accorded them all. There was no needy person among them, for those who owned property or houses would sell them, bring those proceeds of the sale, and put them at the feet of the apostles. And they were distributed to each according to need. The word of the Lord.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His mercy endures forever. Let the house of Israel say, his mercy endures forever. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. This is the day the Lord has rejoice and be glad. The hand of the Lord has struck with power. His right hand is exalted. I shall not die, but live anew, declaring the works of the Lord. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. The stone which the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The Lord of love and mercy has brought wonder to our eyes. This is the day
A reading from the first letter of St. John. Beloved, everyone who believes that Jesus Christ is begotten by God, and everyone who loves the Father, loves also the one begotten by him. In this way we know that we love the children of God when we love God and obey his commandments. For the love of God is this, that we keep his commandments. And his commandments are not burdensome. For whoever is begotten by God conquers the world. And the victory that conquers the world is our faith. Who indeed is the victor over the world, but the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? This is the one who came through water and blood, Jesus Christ, not by water alone, but by water and blood. The Spirit is the one that testifies, and the Spirit is the truth. The word of the Lord.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. You believe in me, Thomas, because you have seen me. Happy are those who have not seen me, but still believe. Alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, Lord.
On the evening of that first day of the week, when the doors were locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in their midst and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. And Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. Whose sins you forgive are forgiven them, and whose sins you retain are retained." Now Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples said to him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger into the nail marks, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." Now a week later, his disciples were again inside and Thomas was with them. Jesus came, although the doors were locked, stood in their midst and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and bring your hand and put it into my side, and do not be unbelieving, but believe." Thomas answered and said to him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you come to believe because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and have believed." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples that are not written in this book, but these are written
that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that through this belief you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord.
This second Sunday of Easter is known in some liturgical circles as Low Sunday, as compared to High Sunday, last Easter, when we pull out all the stops. We kind of get back a little bit more to our normal rhythm of the liturgy on this second Sunday of Easter, even though we continue, actually today is kind of a threshold in our celebration of Easter. It is the conclusion of our celebration of the Easter octave, these 8 days. And throughout this week, we have been reflecting upon the resurrection, the appearances of Jesus to his disciples. That's what we've heard in the Gospels during the course of this week. And Easter week, the octave of Easter, is a chance for us to reflect more upon the events of that first Easter Sunday. As we come together today, we conclude that celebration. Not the end of the Easter season, but the end of the octave. And so as we hear the gospel today, we hear what happened in the evening of that first day of the week, at least as John records it for us. The Easter season will go on for still a number of weeks. And as we go forth in Easter, we kind of change our focus a little bit. We not contemplate so much the events of the first Easter Sunday, but what it means for us. And we'll continue to reflect upon our faith in the risen Lord and how we can grow in that faith. And so our readings today kind of help us to do that, to set the stage, to kind of lead us out of this festive week, but continue in the celebration of the Easter season. And we hear Jesus coming to the disciples who have not yet encountered him after his resurrection. And so John tells us that they are behind locked doors. They are in fear. These are the ones, the same ones who abandoned Jesus when he was arrested. Peter, the one who denied him 3 times, we heard in the Passion on Palm Sunday. The other disciples who fled. It was none of the apostles who were there at the foot of the cross on Good Friday, but only some of Jesus' women disciples. The disciples fled in fear, the apostles. And here they are locked behind locked doors on that first Easter Sunday when Jesus appears to them. And we hear twice, "Peace be with you." For hearts that were troubled and fearful, "Peace be with you," Jesus says. Now what we hear here flows along with the other appearances of Jesus. There, you know, are different details in the different evangelists, but there are some things that are common to all of these stories of the resurrection. One is that fear is overcome by joy. As the disciples recognize that it is indeed Jesus, John tells us that they rejoice when they encounter the Lord, when they hear that greeting from him, "Peace be with you," their fear begins to turn to joy. Just as it does in other accounts, as we hear them in the Gospels. And one of the other things that is common in the resurrection appearances of Jesus, as the disciples recognize who he is, as he reveals himself to them, is the giving of a commission. Jesus, John tells us, breathes on the disciples. "Receive the Holy Spirit." He breathes on them. Just as God, the Holy Spirit, breathed on the waters at the dawn of creation to bring order from the chaos. So Jesus breathes the Holy Spirit upon the disciples to bring order from the chaos of their hearts. as the joy and the love of the risen Christ begins to overcome their fear. And then he says, as the Father has sent me, so I send you. The mission of the church. As the Father has sent me, so I send you. And that will be in time, when the time is right, the disciples will begin to do that. Beginning in Jerusalem, they will begin to give witness to the risen Lord. As their fear has turned to joy, they receive their commission and they go forth enlivened by the Holy Spirit. And throughout Easter, we will be reflecting upon that Easter faith that drove those disciples out. And it's the same Easter faith that is for us. Thomas, who was not there on that first day of the week. From the time I was a kid, I always heard that gospel. Why wasn't Thomas there? Was he out getting a sandwich? I don't know, maybe he run to Subway. But wherever he was, he wasn't there. And it's 8 days later that Thomas has his encounter with the risen Lord. And as powerful as that is, what Jesus says at the end of that exchange is so important for us. Thomas, you saw me and you believe. You're blessed because you saw and believed. But how blessed are those who have not seen and have still believed? The ones to whom the disciples will go, they will not have the same opportunity as the disciples. When Peter and the other apostles, when the disciples go out and begin to share the good news, Jesus is not there in the same way. He is mystically present, but that's the work of the church. As Jesus returns to the Father to complete his work as our Savior, then it's time for the apostles to go and announce what Jesus has taught them. Blessed are those who have not seen, but yet have believed because of what they hear. Because of the witness of the apostles, because of the witness of the early church. Blessed are the generations that would come after the apostles, right down to our own day. We have not seen in the same way Thomas did. Yet, through the testimony of the generations that have come before us, all the way back to the apostles, we have not seen, and yet we believe. And we receive the same commission as those first disciples, to go forth and be witnesses. That baptism that we receive, that baptism that we recall during Easter time, does a lot of things for us. Among other things, we enter into a life of grace with the Lord and we grow in His life. And it is that life with the Lord that should be inflaming our hearts. As we receive the Holy Spirit, just as the disciples received the Holy Spirit, we are enlivened to go forth into the world and to give witness. As the Father has sent me, so I send you. That wasn't just for the first apostles, that's for us. Throughout Easter time, we'll be hearing from the Acts of the Apostles, which gives us some insight into the life of the early church. And that passage that we hear today is important. The disciples, those community of believers, were of one heart and mind. They shared everything in common, and they joyfully lived their lives. That was the witness they were given. It wasn't just the standing up and the preaching. The disciples didn't have catechisms. They didn't have video programs. They didn't have the internet. They didn't have all of the tools that we have. All they had was the witness of their lives. They who had encountered the risen Lord. They who were striving to live that life of grace. That's the witness. And we can use all of those tools, catechisms and videos and YouTube and everything else. But we can never get away from what is most important to us. And it is that relationship with the risen Lord. And if we truly have that relationship, then the fear and the confusion and everything else that sometimes is so much a part of our lives is overcome by joy in knowing Christ. And as the joy of the risen Christ fills our lives, then we can go forth and give witness. We must give witness, not just as individual believers, but as a church. In a world where there is so much confusion and so much fear, but it begins with us. And so as a community of believers, as different as we are brought together by our common faith, our common relationship with Christ. A relationship that is not based on fear. Christ does not want us to fear him. Christ is not the divine taskmaster who's looking for an excuse to condemn us. But the risen Lord is the one who extends peace, who has shown great love. And as we receive that great love, so we must share it. That is our call. That is the wonderful opportunity that we have as disciples. So as we have this Easter season, this time for us to reflect upon our faith in the risen Lord and all that that means for us, all that Easter means for us today, may we make the most of this season of joy. Peace be with you, the Lord says, not just to those first disciples, but to us. And in our time, as we wrestle with the reality of our lives, as we struggle sometimes to understand, as we find ourselves sometimes fearful and angry and disillusioned and whatever else we may feel, allow the peace of Christ, the peace of the risen Lord, to penetrate our hearts. Allow that peace to overcome all, that we may grow in our relationship with the Lord. And as we do, we grow in relationship to one another. And then we can go forth in our great diversity and share the good news. Not of a divine taskmaster, not of a God who wants to punish, but of a God who loves. And by the lives that we lead, may we demonstrate God's love present in us, that we may share that love with our world. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. With faith in the Lord's resurrection and confident in his loving mercy, we offer our prayers for the needs of the world.
The response is, Risen Lord, hear our prayer. That our Christian assemblies may support and nurture the faith body of Christ, especially in our youth who receive the sacrament of confirmation this weekend. We pray, Risen Lord, hear our prayer. That nations' leaders may find solutions for those who are homeless or disposed. We pray, Risen Lord, hear our prayer. That divine mercy may wash away the doubt of all who reject the Lord and his resurrected life. We pray, Risen Lord, hear our prayer. That we who have not seen the risen Lord yet believe may share the peace and forgiveness we have received, we pray. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. That an abundance of men and women will joyfully answer the call of the Lord to proclaim his life, death, and resurrection as priests, deacons, and in consecrated life. We pray. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. For those who in life believe Jesus to be the Son of God, especially Michelle Gallagher, may rejoice and be glad in God's love that endures forever. We pray. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. During this Mass, we remember in a particular way Zora Yorchek Kunda. We pray. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. For the prayers we hold deep in our thoughts, which we now pause to add. Amen.
My Redeemer lives.
that I shall rise again. I know that my Redeemer lives, that I shall rise again.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that this our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Accept, O Lord, we pray, the oblations of your people, that renewed by confession of your name and by baptism, we may attain unending happiness through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation at all times to acclaim you, O Lord. But on this day above all to laud you yet more gloriously, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. For he is the true Lamb who has taken away the sins of the world. By dying he has destroyed our death, and by rising restored our life. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise. And even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts,
You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, Jesus himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread
and drink this cup,
we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray upon the oblation of your church and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, and Saint Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Thomas, Saint Regis, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Larry, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him, with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen, amen, amen.
Together, let us now pray for the coming of God's kingdom as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may always be free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us share with one another a sign of Christ's peace.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from the word. Sweet the rains new fall, sunlit from heaven, like the first dewfall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness of the wet garden, sprung in completeness where God has passed. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one light Eden saw play. Praise with elation, praise every morning, God's recreation of the new day.
Let us pray. Grant, Almighty God, that our reception of this Paschal Sacrament may have a continuing effect in our minds and hearts through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Just a quick update on the DLA. As of last Monday, we were only $400 away from our diocesan target. Once we go past that, everything else we raise to our parish goal and beyond comes back to us assessment-free. So thank you to everybody who's made a contribution to DLA, pledge or gift this year. Your generosity is very greatly appreciated. We've had some more gifts come in during the course of the week that are not counted in the total that you'll see in my column today. So we're just about there. We do want to keep going, though, as I said. Once we get the money coming back to us, we'll be able to do the work we need to do here at the parish. For those who have not yet made a pledge or gift, there's going to be a second mailing that'll be going out within the week or so. So if you get that if you've recently made a gift and you get that second mailing, it's just because the record keeping lags a little bit, so you can disregard it. But that will be coming. Again, thank you to everybody who has made a gift, and if you have not yet done so, please prayerfully consider doing so. The Lord be with you.
Amen.
Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. May God, who by the resurrection of his only begotten Son was pleased to confer on you the gift of redemption and of adoption, give you gladness by his blessing.
Amen.
Heartfelt amen. Amen. Thank you. May he, by whose redeeming work you have received the gift of everlasting freedom, make you heirs to an eternal inheritance.
Amen.
And may you who have already risen with Christ in baptism through faith, by living in a right manner on this earth, be united with him in the homeland of heaven.
Amen.
And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit descend upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
The Mass is ending. Go in peace. Alleluia. Alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Alleluia. And sing, give glory to our risen King. Raise your voices, alleluia. Our Lord who died now truly lives. To us this promise he now gives. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia, alleluia.